I'm Kay Reed, and I'm a paleoecologist and paleontologist, and I focus on finding human ancestors in Africa. I started this project in 2002 with a colleague from the School of Earth and Space Exploration, Ramon Arrowsmith. We were interested in finding early ancestors of the genus Homo, which is our genus, in Ethiopia, because I was familiar with working in Ethiopia because I had worked at the Hadar site from the famous Lucy. And so we started surveying different areas, looking for a time period that we thought might actually contain a fossil of early Homo. And we continued to do that depending on funding in 2004, 2005, 2008, 2012, 13, 15, 18, and 20. And then we were put off until 2024. But we went to the field in 24 and 25. So we've been looking a long time. And we're very happy that we have found a lot of fossil human ancestors, but also a lot of other fossils as well. So we were looking for evidence of Homo at this time period, which is roughly from 3 million to 2.5 million years ago. And it's important because there are not a lot of places, not only in Ethiopia, but in Africa, that have these particular sediments. And so in 2013, we first found a mandible that we attributed to Homo, and we published that, and we continued looking. And then we found in 2018 more evidence of Homo and another species, which is what this paper is about. And the reason this is so cool is because there's two different species of hominin, which is what we call human ancestors, hominins. And the fact that they lived together, lived in the same space, the same time, and they're very similar. So in 2013, we did find a jaw of Homo. And so we published on that already. And we have been looking for other fossils to go with that. You know, just one fossil isn't going to tell us a story about what's going on. And I am sure there are people who think we're wrong. If we only have one, it's a fluke, etc. So this paper discusses the more Homo teeth that we found, the genus Homo dentition, in different areas of our locality. And then we also discovered five molar teeth that go together. So we could make five teeth in a mandible, the back teeth. And those aren't the genus Homo. Those are what we said in this paper from the genus Australopithecus. We also have three front teeth from that same individual. And from these various teeth, we can tell that they're not Australopithecus afarensis. They aren't Lucy's species. They're not another species that's found in the Middle Awash called Australopithecus garhi, because of the placement of the different cusps, et cetera. They're enough different that we think that it's a different species from those, but if you have just the teeth, it's very difficult to have confidence to say, I'm gonna call this Australopithecus lady eye or something like that, because we just can't give it a species name. But we know it's different from the genus Homo, which we also didn't assign a species to. So that's what we're talking about in this paper, but we also continue to look for more evidence so that we can fill in the gaps of the material that we found.
The Afar region still currently is a active rifting environment, so the continent is quite literally unzipping there, which creates a lot of volcanism and tectonics. And this was the same in the past at 2.5, 3 million years ago, And these volcanoes spewed out ash that contain crystals called feldspars that allow us to date them. So we can date the eruptions that were happening on the landscape when they're deposited, and we know that these fossils are interbedded between those eruptions. So we can date units above and below the fossils, and in this case we have, I think, three or four dates across this sequence where we have these two different species preserved, these two different hominins preserved. And so we're dating the volcanic ash and the eruptions that were happening while they were on the landscape, basically. So we're not dating the fossils directly, but we're dating the volcanic ash units above and below where they're found. So we have them well constrained, not only at the bottom of the sequence, but the top of the sequence, and also in between. It really depends on the project. Some are more complicated in terms of their geology than others. For example, in Ledi-Geraru, the main area we've been working at is chopped up by a bunch of different faults. And so you might be working on a geologic unit that you follow across the landscape and then it disappears because a fault has dropped it down or lifted it up in the air somewhere and it's been eroded away. And so constructing the framework, the geologic framework, can take a bit of time. But once you get those dates, which once you collect the samples, may be a year until you find out how old it is. Once you collect all those dates, that framework exists for all the subsequent fossils you find. So we've known these dates pretty much since we found the early Homo jaw and published that in 2015. So 10 years ago, at least, we've known pretty much how old all these sediments are. But it's the yearly process of going back and searching those sediments is what's really time consuming, because fossils, hominin fossils, are extremely rare on the landscape. And so it takes, you know, wind and rain erosion to renew these outcrops and expose more fossils for us to find. And so that's what really takes the time, is quite honestly the footwork of putting in the groundwork, if you will, to spend the time looking for these fossils, even if you've known how old the sediments are for 10 years. It's taken us another almost 10 years to then publish on a new find from this region. That's exactly how rare these fossils are and why we think they're really important and why we need to continue sort of pounding the ground and putting in the groundwork to do this.
We always need more fossils so that we can try to piece things together. But it's really important to understand, and this is, I think, very important, that you often see a diagram where you have sort of a hunched over human, and then you have a little bit more upright human with a bigger brain and a bigger brain, and that's just 1, 2, 3, 4 steps or 10 steps, but it didn't look like that. So you have these two species existing at one time. One of them could have given rise to the lineage that gave rise to us, but maybe they didn't, because evolution doesn't work like that. It's not like progressive, that you go from one species to another to another. And the more information that we have from fossils of different hominid species allows us to sort of see the different ancestor-descendant relationships based on the features that they share. The Homo genus from our site, Ledi-Geraru, on that mandible has 12 different features that other Homo species have. And so the teeth that we found, the new teeth that are in this paper of the Homo species, also have features that make it look like other Homo species, whereas the Australopithecus species doesn't have any of those features. We have a puzzle and we don't have all the pieces. And it's exciting to go out there and find more pieces, which is what we've found.
I mean, it takes patience and it takes a lot of time, and then obviously the funding to get out there and do it. You know, you're looking at little teeth, quite literally individual teeth that look just like a lot of other of the little pebbles spread on the landscape. And so we have a great team of local AFARs that are excellent fossil hunters. They've seen these things their entire lives walking around the landscape. And then it takes a great team of scientists to join them also looking, being know what to recognize from the glint of a piece of enamel or what the bone might look like to make it look fossil versus maybe a goat or cow that was on the landscape, decades ago. And then, of course, the scientific team to analyze that and figure out how it fits into the fossil record, be it the hominins themselves or the other fossils that we find on the landscape. We find a fair amount of fossils every year. It's just that the hominins are an extremely rare component of that. And then seeing how do they compare to other fossils we have, both at that same time, later in time, before. So it's a multidisciplinary project, not just amongst the scientists, but amongst our local Afar community there, which are amazing fossil finders. They're far better than any of us in terms of my perspective.
These critters were living in an area different from today. Today, it's mostly a semi-desert, very little rainfall, etc. And we know back then there were rivers, and they might not have been flowing year-round, but there were rivers. The animals tell us there were a lot of grasses around, and to put that sort of in a perspective, the fossil giraffe mammals were eating grass, and today giraffes eat trees. They eat leaves from trees, so it was grassy. But along the rivers, there were some trees. We have evidence of some trees. So it's, I guess you could call it a savanna. I don't like to use that word because people then just picture the Serengeti. But it had grass and it had some trees, but it was more arid than Lucy's time, which was before 3 million years ago.
You know, there's sort of, I think a lot of people, maybe not everyone, have an inherent interest in their origins, whether that's more recent origins or their deep time origins. I mean, kids like dinosaurs, why? They're cool. Early human fossils, I think, are cool too, and they're directly related to you, right? You can look at their teeth, you can look at their jaws, and you can see yourself in that, right? They may be 3 million years older than you, but there's a resemblance. There's sort of a humanity to it, and part of you in that. And I think that these fossil finds, from a scientific perspective, are very important in terms of fleshing out the details of our history. But I think even for the lay people reading these papers or these news articles, is that it gives them a touch to the deep past, right? It's something they can connect with and give them a deeper sense of place in the universe.
I am so excited that we found these particular fossils, but I'm also really happy and curious about what happens next, because it's never over. Not necessarily even with, yes, I'd love to find more stuff at Ledi-Geraru, absolutely. But I'm also excited about the other finds that will be found. And as someone mentioned, it is. We did a good chapter here in the story of human evolution, and it makes me happy.